Belinda Audio presents this unabridged recording of 44 Tiny Acrobats by Sylvia Bishop and read by Imogen Sage. For my family, with love, kiss, SB. For Sam and Liz, thank you for being the ultimate and inspiring friends with the warmest and biggest of hearts, kiss, kiss, AK. Our first act, the incredible unwanted circus. It was the first day of the Christmas holidays, and for Betsy Bow Linnet and her granddad, that meant it was Christmas decorations day. Granddad had got the boxes out of the cellar as usual and started whistling Christmas tunes as usual, but something wasn't usual about him, and Betsy didn't know what was wrong. "Let the mayhem begin, Bee," he said. He tucked some tinsel round his head. "First things first, we must decorate your old granddad. How do I look?" He was pretending to have fun, but Betsy wasn't fooled. Normally his elbows wafted merrily around when he talked or moved or breathed. Today they drooped at his sides like two sad worms in a cardigan. And if Grandad was only pretending to have fun, then Betsy couldn't really have fun either. The only ones who were having fun were Betsy's 44 African pygmy mice. This was their first experience of Christmas decorations. Betsy and Grandad pulled out baubles and bells and bright pieces of ribbon, and each new treasure caused a wave of astonished squeaking and, unfortunately, nibbling. The mice were normally very well behaved, but ever since the cold winter weather had set in, some instinct had made them start eating everything in sight. "Alas," said Grandad, holding up a paper angel, "his heavenly foot hath been chewed. We might have to put the mice away, Bee." "Oh no," said Betsy. "They get so sad if I keep them cooped up all day." Grandad nodded.
"A distraction, then."
He ferreted around in the decorations box and held up some old worms of tinsel.
"How about they learn some acrobatics? We could hang these from the doorway for them."
This was a good idea. Betsy strung up the tinsel and showed the mice how to climb up and down and swing back and forth. It worked like a charm. They went scurrying around the colourful strands with squeaks of glee, while Betsy and Grandad got on with the decorations in peace. Grandad kept up his determined whistling, but he didn't chatter away as usual, and he did everything just a bit too slowly. It felt as though he needed winding up again, like tired clockwork. "Grandad," said Betsy at last, "is everything all..." Grandad held up a wreath and examined it.
"Ding dong merrily on high," he sang. "A mouse has chewed his holly."
The mice innocently swung back and forth on their tinsel, whiskers akimbo.
"I just mean," said Betsy, "you seem a bit..."
"Ding dong verily awry, their insides can't fill jolly."
"Grandad," she tried once more, "is there..."
But Grandad cut her off with a
"back in a tick, Bee,"
and went whistling off to hang the wreath on the door, elbows drooping sadly. So Betsy went back to hanging tiny baubles on the hundreds of rare and exotic ferns that her mother filled the house with and tried to think what might be bothering him. Out of the corner of her eye, she kept watch on the mice. They had got so good at controlling the swing of the tinsel strands that they were now swinging them into complicated plaits. This was not surprising. The mice were remarkably clever. When Betsy had first been given them, they had already been trained to play the piano. That's why there were 44 of them. They each played two of the piano's 88 notes, and they all had names like G to G sharp fourth octave. Betsy had to keep them a secret when they first arrived, and those 44 tiny secrets had caused her a lot of trouble. But that's another story. They weren't secrets now, and they could do much more than play the piano. Betsy had taught them lots of new tricks. They could jump through tiny hoops and do cartwheels and paw stands and star jumps and draw pictures with inky paws and use a can opener if they all worked together and pushed very hard. Betsy watched as D-flat to D-fifth octave made an impressive leap between two bits of tinsel. B to C second octave tried to join in, but got confused and leaped on to a nearby fern instead. Betsy went to coax him off before he got round to nibbling it. When Grandad came back in, he was still whistling stubbornly and he dodged all Betsy's concerned questions. Betsy sighed and decided she would have to tell her parents about it to see if they could get to the bottom of the problem. It turned out that she didn't need to tell them. Somehow her parents already knew. When they arrived home 10 minutes later, they were both armed with up-cheering things. Her mother, Bella, had brought a book of piano duets. She and Grandad were both excellent pianists and loved to play together. Her father, Bertram, was clutching a bulging bag of cream cakes. He had given up playing the piano these days, but was an excellent cream cake eater, and he loved to eat them, with or without anybody else. And they had both brought enormous smiles and chirpy voices and enthusiasm.
"I thought we could play a few duets together, Dad," exclaimed Bella.
"And I thought I could have an afternoon tea," exclaimed Bertram, with his mouth full of an eclair that he was sampling just to make sure it was all right.
Grandad tried to roll his eyes and wink at Betsy when the other two weren't looking, but his heart wasn't really in it. It ended up being more wobbling his eyes and squinting a bit. Bella won the enthusiasm contest, and Grandad went off with her to play duets. Bertram looked at his cream cake sadly. Then he realised something and cheered up at once.
"Well, Bee," he said, opening the bag, "I guess these are all for you and me then."
Betsy looked at him with his armful of up-cheering cakes. What did he know that she didn't?
"Dad," she said, "what's wrong with Grandad?"
From above, a soft duet began. Bertram looked at Betsy kindly over his half-moon spectacles and said,
"Have you looked out of the window today, Bee? At the front?"
"No."
"Come and see."
So Betsy followed Bertram, dodging the swinging mice in the doorway, over to the bay window in the parlour. The Bow Linnets lived in a London townhouse where Bertram had grown up. And although it was tired around the edges and a bit of a mess, mostly because of ferns and pianos and, of course, mice, it was quite grand and had beautiful views. It looked across the road to a wide common, which was normally only occupied by a few dog walkers and a huddle of crows. But today, the far side of the common was a hive of activity. Somebody had put boards down over a large patch of grass, and there were colourful vans parked everywhere, with Fry and Sons written on the side. In among the vans, people were bustling about, laughing and calling to each other. Watching them, Betsy felt a strange sense of longing.
"That," said Bertram, "is your grandma's circus."
Betsy did her best to turn off the sense of longing sharpish, because she absolutely did not want anything to do with Grandma's circus. When her mother Bella had been 7, Betsy's grandma Beryl had left her and Grandad to go back to her old circus life. She was a fabulous animal trainer and performed with dogs and horses and other creatures under the name Gloria Sprightly. She even had mice like Betsy's, which had been her granddad's idea. She had died a little while ago, but Betsy had never met her. They hardly ever talked about it. The memories were too painful.
"It hasn't been in town since you were very small," said Bertram. "Just arrived today. Bit of a nasty shock for poor old granddad."
Betsy could see that it must have been. She tried very hard to focus on the memory of Grandad's drooping elbows and not to feel even a little bit excited as the bustling people began to lay a great tent over the ground and circle round it, ready to raise it up to full height. "So," said Bertram, "we'll all just have to ignore it and be extra nice to Grandad. Your mother has tickets for you three to see a concert tonight, to take his mind off things. I wish I could come, but I have to go and see Great Aunt Agatha." He turned a little pale as he said this. Bertram's great aunt was a fearsome woman, and his monthly dinners with her filled him with dread. "So," he said bravely, "can I count you in for Operation Cheer Up Grandad, B?" Betsy nodded and turned away from the excitement outside. The mice were now leaping between the tinsel strands in time to the soft piano music above, chirping blissfully. But at that moment, F to F sharp first octave leaped with a bit too much aplomb and not quite enough accuracy and tumbled to the floor with a tiny, terrified squeal. Betsy and Bertram stood frozen for a mouse-sized nanosecond, then rushed over, saying things like, "Oh no, oh no, oh no," and "Please be okay, please be okay, please be okay," and "Oh." For a moment, the little comber of reddish-brown fur lay very still. But as they watched, he heaved a trembling breath and gathered himself onto his paws. Then he twitched all over, as though finding out what was still in the right place. "He's okay," said Betsy, kneeling down to see. "He's okay." She held out the back of her hand and F to F sharp first octave crawled on, dragging his right front leg. You should always avoid picking up an African pygmy mouse. They are so small, they might get squashed.
"Something a bit off with his paw, isn't there?" said Bertram, crouching alongside her. Betsy nodded.
"Squeech," said the mouse, sadly.
Betsy stroked him very gently, his spine a tiny string of beads under his fur, and tried to pull herself together. It was almost too much to have a sad granddad and an injured mouse on Christmas decorations day. But if she got upset too, then things were only going to get worse. So she just had to treat it like a messy room, roll up her sleeves and set about putting things right. First, she would get the mouse to the vets, because that's the best thing to do for a mouse with a painful paw. Then she would find out what was best for a granddad with a painful memory and do that, whatever it was.
"I'll call the vets," she said to Bertram.
"Yes, good idea," he said. "Poor little fellow."
The vet couldn't see them until 6 o'clock. Bertram would have left for his great aunt's by then, so he suggested asking Bella to go with her, but Betsy wouldn't hear of it.
"Mum's got to take Grandad to the concert," she insisted. "The vet's is only on the other side of the common. I can go by myself. Looking after Grandad is more important."
"Don't worry, Bee. Grandad's all right, really," Bertram began. But then Grandad came down to make tea, singing the word tea repeatedly to the tune of Jingle Bells. Betsy and Bertram exchanged glances as he shuffled past them. Grandad was brilliant at making up songs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.